Hi, I'm Meg from XQ, and I am very excited to be here today with Justin. Justin, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
Justin is a learning scientist focused on learning at scale and learning for the future at MIT Teaching Systems Lab. Over the past couple months, he's been helping educators and school leaders make sense of education amidst COVID-19. And today he's here to speak with us about how educators and school leaders can be planning for the future during this time. So Justin, I know that there's still a lot of uncertainty for our educators and school leaders, and they're really doing their best during this time. I'd love to hear from you what you may suggest that educators and school leaders consider as they're planning ahead.
Well, I think so one of my experiences in my life is that I used to run a search and rescue group, all kinds of emergencies across the country are run using a system called the Incident Command System. So whether it's big wildfires or other kind of disasters or things like that. So we actually know something about the science of responding to emergencies. And one of the things that people have learned over many years of dealing with crises is that even when it feels like we should all be attending to the crisis at hand, it's almost always a good idea to have some people who are set aside planning ahead. So in the incident command system, most people work in a group that's called operations, putting out the fire or looking for the lost people or dealing with whatever the crisis is. But emergency managers have learned that it's really important to take a couple of people and have them form some kind of planning group looking ahead to the future. When I used to do search and rescue group, we would take two smart people and put them in a church basement in rural Virginia somewhere and give them a bunch of maps and give them new information every hour and say, imagine what this could look like tomorrow. Imagine what this could look like a week from now. And I think now in many places across the country, we've sort of stabilized. We've gotten into some patterns and rhythms around remote learning. And there's probably not that much we can do with the last 15 or 30 days of school to make a huge difference in that. But I think there's an enormous difference that we can make with planning to think about what the summer looks like and what coming back to school in the fall looks like.
Wow, that makes a lot of sense, Justin. And I had no idea that that was a part of your background. So always great to learn more about you. Where should these smaller groups or this subset of educators start?
So one conceptual shift that I would encourage people to start trying to wrap their heads around it is hard, is that there's going to be some degree of remote learning next year. It is very unlikely that all of our school buildings are going to be fully repopulated all year long. So the first thing to start doing is start imagining what some of those models might look like. I mean, I could imagine school districts saying, we're actually going to take our elementary school students and put them in middle school buildings, put them in high school buildings. Just the first folks we need to get back are our youngest students so that their parents can get back to work. And because those are the students who will have the most difficult time with more online remote learning. But other districts will make other options. They'll say, let's bring some kids back on Mondays and Wednesdays and other kids back on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And every school district is going to be at risk all year long of having viral flare-ups. So there may be schools in rural Vermont, rural Montana that are safe to go back to from September to December. But then in some of those places, flu season will hit and everyone's going to have to go home to re-quarantine for 4 weeks or 8 weeks or something like that. So those are some of the models that we have to start imagining, you know, what's going to be the right fit for our particular community. Since all of those models involve some degree of remote learning, I think the most important thing for people to get their heads wrapped around is that remote learning is coached homeschooling. We have a bunch of virtual schools that operate under non-pandemic conditions in this country and around the world. And the way that they operate typically is that they send computers with curriculum that is mostly meant to be done asynchronously. And assumes the presence of a full-time parent or caregiver. And then what teachers end up doing is they coach parents and caregivers about how to support their students through those curricula. We need to figure out how we support parents, caregivers, communities, siblings, tutors, other kinds of people. If we know that kids are not going to spend a full year at school next year, we're going to have to figure out how we ramp up all these other people to be able to support folks at home. So that's like a big conceptual shift to get our heads wrapped around. How do we support in a way that we've never had to before school family partnerships that really empower families to be successful in supporting learning? And some of that is thinking about just what are the kinds of things that we can do best, are most important to do in the limited time we have in school, and then what are the kinds of things that families can be most successful doing at home, and thinking about where each of those things fit.
That makes a lot of sense. And as educators and school leaders are thinking about the fewer things that may need to happen in school versus out of school, what do you think is an approach to looking at that? Or how should educators go about selecting what is most essential?
So I think one starting point might be to, before you zoom too quickly at the right answer, to come up with a bunch of possible answers. So consider putting together planning teams that have some administrators, some parents, some students, some teachers, some paraprofessionals, and start doing some design exercises to say, what are some different ways that we could approach these challenges? Like, what's the end of the first marking period going to look like next fall? What do we want the first day of school to look like? What do we want students to feel the first time they walk back into the building? What do we want to prioritize and tell them is really important? If we have 2 days of school learning and 2 days of remote learning, how do we prepare for that? What might one curriculum, you know, if we're a middle school, let's pick one subject and one unit and think about, if we have to close for two more weeks, how could we do that really well? One of the real challenges that schools face is that our work is extremely granular. What it takes to adapt a seventh grade earth science unit on plate tectonics is different than what it takes to do a first grade unit on phonics and diphthongs. So there's no centralized group that's going to be able to figure out all of those things. You know, when schools get a sense of what the bigger picture looks like, then it's going to be up to grade level teams, up to department teams to say, okay, how do we make this work for world language study? How do we make this work for physical education? You know, hopefully some of those big building blocks really put student wellness first. I mean, we just did this report called Remote Learning Guidance from State Education Agencies During COVID-19. The folks in my lab went and read at the end of March all of the guidance that all 50 states had published on their websites. And one of the things that struck us is that folks said, you know, for the most part, schedules that look to be about half the school day for older students and then progressively less for younger students. But even within that restricted time, almost every sample schedule that we saw from states with all kinds of different, you know, pedagogical philosophies said there has to be time for creative expression every day and there have to be time for exercise every day. That's just something our kids need when they're at home. So even in the midst of all the changes that we're making, we've got to think about, you know, how do we center student wellness? How do we really think about all of the inequalities, you know, the savage inequalities, as Jonathan Kozol used to say, that are being shown in our system. How do we set up families that have more resources and that can do more of this homeschooling better to kind of be more able to work independently so that we can really focus our resources on, you know, families that are poverty impacted and their parents or their single parent or essential workers or just folks that have less, you know, students that have less support at home. How can we really pour our resources into that? So that the widening inequalities that we have in our society don't continue to grow over the course of next year. Those are some of the things that I'm thinking about as schools need to wrestle and plan with the future.
That's really helpful. And at the start of what you're saying, you mentioned schools thinking about the different expectations for students. I'm curious, and I'd love to hear from you, what do you feel are some of the real opportunities there and the dangerous aspects of reevaluating expectations for students and reevaluating expectations for learning at this time?
So I think the most likely scenario is that next year we will not do as much academic learning as in a typical school year like we have over the last 10 years. So given that that's a reality, if we know we have fewer instructional minutes next year, we've got to think strategically about what that means. I think in a lot of places, states, to some extent, states are going to make these decisions, but districts and teachers make these decisions too. Do you want to try to hold your standards level so that you can measure how far short you're falling of those standards? Or do you want to be strategic about saying, look, we're just not going to cover as much next year. So let's strategically pick the things that we do want to make sure that we do really well. I don't think it'll be wise for schools to kind of double down on the broccoli. I don't think it'll be wise for schools to say, let's just clear out all the things that kids love about school and focus on test prep and making sure that they're ready for that. I think we're going to still have to do wellness and arts and music and theater and all the parts of school. You know, I mean, there's lots of parts of academic learning that kids love, but we can't crowd all of that out. I keep thinking that what we want schools to do is both be really ambitious in doing everything they can to help students make academic progress while also being realistic about the challenges we face. And to me, that combination of ambition and realism, that speaks to trying to do fewer things well. To say what are, you know, and lots of our curriculum, I think, is amenable to that. So I used to be a high school history teacher. In ninth grade world history, you know, maybe in previous years you covered six empires. Maybe this year you only aim to do four, and we still want to do those four really well. And maybe if we do them really well, we go on to five and six. But, you know, like in a lot of subjects, students will, you know, they will go on to lead rich and healthy lives if we study fewer things well. There's some other subjects, you know, math, early elementary reading, where some of that might be harder. I mean, certainly sitting at MIT, when we look at a lot of the science and engineering curriculum in high school, we're thinking, boy, that looks pretty overstuffed to begin with. You know, maybe we would want those, you know, the biology curriculum to have fewer things done well anyway. And this is a time to sort of test that. But you know, I think there are other states, there are other school systems that are going to say, well, let's just, you know, pedal to the metal, try to do as much as we can. And those will be interesting experiments to look at too. There's a case to be made that if we keep our standards high, then people will rise up to them. If we keep our expectations high, people will rise up to them. But we also have to recognize that there are vast inequalities in our society. There are millions of families that are not well connected to the internet. There's a great report in EdWeek today about teachers in rural areas who are driving to school to be able to teach remotely during the day because they don't have Wi-Fi at home. And some of these things that we can fix by spending money on upgrading people's plans, but there are a lot of places where there just like aren't fiber optic lines that are going out to people's homes. And we're not going to roll, hopefully we invest as much as possible as broadband as a national utility. But again, we need to be realistic about the limits of what can be accomplished during a pandemic. And we need to be sensitive to the fact that in many cases, it's the most vulnerable members of society who are being most negatively affected by the disease, by lack of access to treatment, those kinds of things. And figuring out how we address those inequalities, to me, it seems like it's a really important time for us to prioritize carefully and strategically.
Absolutely. And I imagine that in thinking about what will be covered in the year to come, many teachers and educators are really focused on potentially making up for lost time. How should educators and school leaders be thinking about remediation in the year to come?
So I think it's absolutely appropriate. It's a totally natural thing for educators to do to say, you know, well, what did we miss this spring and how do we make that up? One thing that I am concerned about is that leading too much into a deficit framing around kids. So we just filmed this beautiful video of for a course that we make called Becoming a More Equitable Educator. It's with an instructional coach at Sci High, which is a XQ school down in Florida. And she says, look, if you're a ninth grader and you're so-called behind in your reading, you have been told that you're below grade level every day of your academic career. If those students come to school in the fall and we say to our most poverty impacted, most recession affected, most coronavirus affected students, whoa, now you're really behind. I mean, that's just a recipe for psychological disaster. A big part of what we need to do when students come back in the fall is celebrate the incredible learning that's been done all across the country by so many families. Not all of it has been academic learning. Some of it has been learning how to do chores around the house. Some of it has been learning how to get along with our family members. Some of it has been interest-driven learning. We have to celebrate that. And we have to celebrate the incredible resiliency, you know, and community spirit that so many students and family have shown during this period. And then in the midst of that, we need to also recognize that some kids in the third grade didn't learn all the things that they really need to be successful in the fourth grade. But I think we can't come at that and say, well, you know, we need to say, well, maybe some instead of just you know, remediating that. I mean, I'm really concerned about schools saying, okay, affluent kids, you all get to go to room 202 and keep doing the fourth grade, and kids in poverty impacted neighborhoods who didn't have access to the internet, you've got to go to room 201 and do grade 3.5. I think we need to figure out, you know, my colleague John Mehta at Harvard says, can we do remediation with a scalpel instead of with a sledgehammer? Can we find the targeted things that we need to remediate on while still having kids move forward and make progress? I mean, you know, and obviously there are all kinds of exceptions all across education. And so there'll be different kinds of heterogeneous groupings that we need to do and things like that. But, you know, this, there's a colleague of mine who said, you know, it's like there was a huge tidal wave which has revealed the ocean floor, and we're now seeing the vast inequalities that are on that ocean floor, and we don't want to come back in the fall and just keep replicating them.
Yeah, absolutely. And I find that so powerful in this moment where there's not as many hopeful areas to look for, that really students are building so many skills, and the resilience that is being learned is really incredible. How else can school leaders and educators be applying asset-based thinking, both right now and in the upcoming school year?
Well, to me, this notion of resilience is really helpful because even, you know, there may be some teachers out there that are discouraged that they're not making as much academic progress as they would like to, that kids, you know, are connecting but are not always able to do all the work that we're hoping that they're able to do, or things like that. The research that we have on education during emergencies, during refugee crises, during other kinds of crises, it suggests to us that education is a really important protective factor for young people during crises. The education provides some schedule and routine. It provides connections to peers and trusted adults. It provides intellectual stimulation. So even if the work that we're doing as educators right now isn't meeting all the goals that we hope for, it's really important. It's really making a difference in young people's lives. Even the kids that we're not connecting with most effectively, you know, the calls, the texts that parents are making to track down families, to track down kids that are not well connected, it really matters for young people's health, well-being, and resilience. I said that the fall is a good time to celebrate all the resilience that folks have shown and the learning they've done. I also think the end of the year could be a great time for that. There's huge chunks of time that we used to devote to standardized assessments that we filled in these chunks of time that we don't have to do this year. But let's still think about how there can be culminating activities, how we can celebrate all the learning that folks are doing, that we can celebrate all the resilience that youth have shown as a way of sort of closing out this year. So those seem like promising approaches to me. I also think just remembering there are going to be a lot of kids that come back, and we can't define them by the things they missed. We have to be attentive to the things they missed, because some of those gaps are real and they're going to be meaningful for kids' lives. But we just have to constantly remember that students thrive when we help them identify their strengths. You know, there's a lot of kids who probably don't realize how much they're learning or how much they're accomplishing right now. Part of our job as educators is to find that and to celebrate that. I used to work with a wrestling coach named Steve Tubman. Steve Tubman had this genius that he could look at every kid who walked in the room, and I would be like, that is a gangly person who will never be, and he'd be like, no, that kid's got really long arms, a lot of leverage, we're going to teach him headlocks, we're going to teach him throws, and that's going to be his success. And, you know, boys and eventually girls, just everyone who walked in the room, Steve Tubman had this imagination for how a kid could be a great wrestler, and that was something that I always took away from him. Like, what does it look like to look at every kid and just imagine them as the most successful possible version of themselves, to see the things in themselves that kids don't often recognize for their own part, and to be able to support that. I think that's one of the most important skills in teaching, is having that imagination for our students.
Definitely, and that's such a beautiful sentiment and practice. Thank you for sharing that. I also want to appreciate how you have called out what a difficult time this is for students and families and educators. And I know at this time we're facing, educators in particular, are facing new routines, new challenges, and exacerbated inequities. But we're also seeing unprecedented creativity and, as you said, resilience. I'd love to hear from you, what is really hopeful, and where do you see opportunities in education in this moment?
So we're by necessity asking students to become more self-regulated learners. And I think, you know, there are some students who are already good at that who are thriving. There are some students who are really struggling with that who we need to help. But there are, I think, a whole bunch of students in the middle who, you know, have never been asked to be this independent before, who are stepping up. I was hearing, reading some stories online, so there are some students from historically marginalized, minoritized backgrounds who, when they go to school, they experience them, you know, as racist and bigoted places where they don't have the best experiences. And some of those students in the midst of the pandemic are like, oh, mom, is this what college is going to be like? Like, I get to set my own schedule and I get to, you know, pursue my own interests more and I get to choose who I want to interact with. This is great. So I think there, you know, for all the, there, one thing I've been telling people, is, you know, being in the privileged position of being able to talk to folks from lots of different places is that everyone is having a different pandemic. There are some teachers who are younger and tech savvy and don't have dependents at home, and they used to have a 45-minute commute each way, and they just got that time back, and they thrive under adversity, and they're doing great. They're finding, you know, there are lots of people who are really finding all kinds of creative ways to support remote learning in really powerful ways. And then there are teachers who have a new infant at home and have a third grader and a fourth grader and are trying to teach their ninth grade class, and they're just getting destroyed right now. You know, they're sort of hanging on with their fingertips to the world. And, you know, and I'm hoping that what we can find there is a lot of community support, a lot of leadership for support for those educators, and just the recognition that, you know, in normal non-pandemic times, the structure of your family has very little to do with your quality as a teacher. It happens to matter quite a bit right now. You know, if there are five of you in the house trying to fight over the, you know, the squeaking broadband that's going through, you can't do the great work that you're able to do when you're in those buildings with kids. And, you know, similar kids, there's some kids that are thriving right now. There's some kids that are really struggling. But I think, you know, certainly a huge part of the hope is the extraordinary civic mindedness that the entire nation has shown in being willing to stay home and to protect our frontline healthcare workers, to be able to protect our other essential workers. You know, I mean, it's a strange kind of fight, a strange kind of war to wage that just asks us to stay home and to be together. And there are lots of families that are making the most of it. And then what we need to do between now and next year is to realize that's going to be part of our lives moving forward. Even if we open things up, they're not going to be opened back fully. And so we need to do everything that we can to support families and caregivers at doing more of this instructional work. Is to find, you know, we're going to have to find the teacher inside all of us who take care of the nation's 58 million children, and recognize that some families can't do that because they're families of essential workers, or they're, you know, impacted by other kinds of things. And so the communities and school communities are really going to have to wrap those students with a lot of love and a lot of care and a lot of support to be able to be successful. But, you know, it's almost like the whole nation needs to be really ramping up over the next 5 months to say, okay, we're going to get through this now. We're going to have a summer to keep getting healthier and to keep recuperating and resting and learning during that period of time, everything that we can learn to be able to ramp up in the fall and do our very best as a country to help kids have a terrific, if strange, school year.
Justin, thank you so much for sharing all of your insights today. It was wonderful to hear about the challenges and considerations that we should be thinking about, as well as some of the hopeful potential bright spots for the future. So really just want to thank you again for spending the time with us and walking us through all of this.
Yeah, thanks for making all these resources available to educators and families. It's great.
Thank you.